Hello and welcome to The Hive. This is Season 11, Episode 4.
This is a very special episode featuring segments from both our photojournalism and photo video classes.
Up first, we introduce one of our newest clubs here at Lebanon High School, D&D Club. Here you can roll die, hang out with friends, and enjoy a campaign run by one of our fabulous dungeon masters. Even if you don't know how to play, they'll teach you. Let's allow Isaac and a few others to explain a little bit further, shall we?
I am Isaac Lindsay.
Zebediah Bruna.
My name is Mason Walker.
Elizabeth Hutton.
It's kind of just a fun place to go after school and hang out with some friends and just do whatever you need to do. Just hang out, play a game, card games, anything you really need to do.
It's very interesting. You know, D&D is one of my favorite things to do. It's controlled chaos, really, in the best way imaginable.
We get to play D&D, very fun game, my personal opinion, father of all role-playing games. Has quite literally infinite possibilities.
How many people are there just to support me, and they support everyone. Like, just Gavin Dismang, he is one of the kindest, most gentle people you will ever meet in this school.
I like just hanging out with friends, being adventurers, and just having a great time.
Well, what I like about D&D Club is that there's a lot of collaboration between DM and players. Everyone around seems to be really nice and enjoys playing D&D. A lot of fun to be had.
On the small room, it's a little difficult to work with. Tables aren't the best, but that's not a big deal, and just the noise. It's very manageable, though.
Well, dislikes, we can only play so many times a week, once.
D&D Club was just started this past year, the school year, and a couple kids came to me who, one of them was a former student, the other one I had just met that day, and asked if I could sponsor the club, and I thought that'd be fine, so we started it back in the fall of 2021. It's always open for new members. Even if you don't know how to play D&D, they're willing members to show you how to play, and it gets competitive and a bit loud sometimes, but it's a nice place for people to come and learn about it. We usually meet pretty much every Wednesday from about 3:30 to 4:30, and you can get added to the listserv of emails so you know when we're meeting or if we do have to cancel last minute. It's a fun environment and you should try to check it out if you're at any bit interested at all.
Check out the most funky event of the year, the 2022 annual Dancing with the Stars.
And our winners of the 12th annual 2022 LHS Dancing with the Stars are...
Lost the hat.
But you know, I improvised in the moment. Taste of your lips,
I'm on a roll. I think that went
really
great.
Good.
That
I was really impressed with us. I do.
With that performance, I think we were
yes.
Went really good. Had a lot of energy. Love Harry Styles.
Yep. Golden.
He made it great. Golden. We were.
It went really good.
Whew.
I was very lightheaded, and so I was just hoping to hit the moves.
Yeah, the adrenaline kicks in when it starts, and everything's a little bit more, a little extra.
I feel like I just got done running a track meet. I'm so out of breath, but I think it was good.
good.
We hit all of our tricks and in time too. Really tired.
Yeah, I can barely breathe.
But it was really fun.
Adrenaline when you get out there, like for some sure. of those things you don't even realize you're doing, and it's like, man, we're actually doing it. I thought it went really, really well.
Third place. Dancing team number two, we've got Dakota Windsor and Haley Lundy.
In second place, dancing team number seven, Libby Hayes and Matt Jackson.
And our winners of the 12th annual 2022 LHS Dancing with the Stars are
Maya Huff and Grant
Sharp.
Up next comes science and its ability to win awards with expert scientists. A video produced by Castor Stiro.
LHS research is designed to offer up an opportunity to provide kids with a chance to explore a research project that is in their field of interest and to complete an independent, high quality research project and then enter it in competitions at the end of the year. The highlights, so definitely seeing some student success is always good. We had two students that were able to publish in a scientific journal, and then we had several students win some scholarships and prize money at the Ozark Science and Engineering Fair. And then we also had a student that got invited to attend the International Science and Engineering Fair that will take place in May. I always enjoy seeing students maximize sort of their potential here at the high school, I guess you could say. Seeing students devote a ton of time and effort and energy into an area that they're extremely passionate about is always awesome to see. And so as long as that continues, I'll be extremely happy. The challenge of science research, we have a saying in this class, fail forward. And so our saying of failing forward is, it comes with the idea that there will be failure, and there will be sort of the approach that once there is failure to sort of pick ourselves back up and continue the scientific process. And so with every project we had, we would have students that fail, they have to redesign their project, they have to redesign how they collect their data, or restart their project altogether. So failure is very common, and that's our biggest challenge every year.
My research dealt with biofortification with calcium of radishes, which is a technology that aims to increase the nutrient content of food crops through modified growing practices. So I watered a bunch of radishes through their whole life, and with hard water that had extra calcium in it, and to see if it would increase the final nutrient content of the radishes. And it didn't work. My results were not significant, but I mean, now we know that it doesn't work. So that's what we learned from that.
My research was over the use of ferrofluids in removing microplastics from rivers. So ferrofluids and microplastics are both nonpolar, so they attract each other. And ferrofluids are magnetic. So when you pull the ferrofluids out with a magnet, the microplastics will come with them. So I was using this to design a filter using magnets. It was based off of a water wheel, and then as the wheel would spin with the water, it would pull the ferrofluids out and the microplastics. And my data was statistically significant, but it's just a filter element, not a fully functioning filter.
It was really cool. The publishing took a very long time. It was about 8 months of peer review from when I first submitted it. But because of that, it was my last year's paper, and I learned a lot about how to write a good, like, scientific writing. And so this year's paper is much better. And then winning awards, it was surreal. I went in not expecting to win much, and I did. So that was surprising.
Winning awards was very cool because I also was not expecting it. Like, I kind of thought my project was a disaster, but then it really turned out really well, and I won some awards.
I think the time management of it is challenging when you first start, because you always underestimate how long it's going to take. And then if something goes wrong, you're way behind. I grow plants for mine too, so that takes a long time. I can't put in a 14-hour day and get all my data then if I have to. My radishes grew for almost 8 weeks in first semester, and then I had to go to MSU to use their equipment. And so using the time correctly is challenging.
My issue is definitely also time management and also motivation. So I ended up doing my data like right before I needed my data, but it all turned out fine in the end, so it's okay.
Let's learn more about the effects of the Russia-Ukrainian war on the Ukrainian people. Up next, a video produced by Kelsey Lawson.
Well, it was of the year 2014 and 15. And my first host family, it was a Long's family, Josie Long and Stephen Long, with Alisa Long and Lydia Long and Kay Long as siblings. And then I spent the last month of my exchange year with Crowell's family, with Karabes and Ron Crowell. He was a coach of basketball and tennis, I remember. Well, I can't complain now because I'm safe, but mentally it's been rough times. There was like a day before the war started, I started feeling kind of nervous. So I told my husband, I was like, hey, let's take that opportunity and wait somewhere. And the next day I woken up and I see that I have a lot of missed calls. Wow. And because of my position at work, I kind of try not to keep my phone, you know, like with sound or vibration. So like I totally didn't have like any kind of alarm or anything. I looked at my phone and I saw a lot of missed calls from my family, from my mom, from my best friends. And I was like, what happened? I didn't realize. And I was like recalling my mom, and my mom was like, Diana, why don't you pick up your phone? Like, there is a war. We're in the process of bombing everything. Bombs are coming to the ground. What happened? And I look at the window and I see that military helicopter passing by on the window. I freaked out, really, I freaked out. I was screaming to my husband, hey, take the suitcases, start preparing clothes. We are getting evacuating. A few days before, few weeks, I would say, before war, I prepared emergency bags, which was advised from my country, that to have documents. And I was pretty calm. I was telling my husband, you know, we have to put some documents, money, maybe some food to emergency bags. And I made up a decision pretty fast because I was but mom, what should I do? You know, kind of asking for an advice. And my mom was hey, you know, I never been in that situation. I can't decide where to go, because my mom lives 21 kilometers from Odessa. The town's name is Chornomorsk. And I remembered that in my office in Odessa, we do have a basement. And I was because it's so unsafe to stay on the 10th floor. So I was okay, we're just getting my cat, my husband, everyone to that basement. So we went there with all of our stuff. We kind of started preparing, you know, you start doing stuff you never done before. You start blocking the windows in the basement. Those are really small ones, but there are windows, and you realize if it's bombing that they could come to you. You start thinking that way. You start think about things you would never expect to think of.
This year's video photo students have made a variety of horror and comedy short films. Up next on The Hive.
Never in a million years do I think today is going to be the day my life flashed before my eyes.
Looking at me.
Let's go. You guys ready to go develop some photos in?
Yeah, I think we should. Mr. Adams has been wanting us to do that.
Isn't it kind of late?
No. I think we need to. We need to just get done.
I think we should just wait, though.
No, it's come on. We have to.
It's
come
been
on.
A while.
We really need to get
I
that
mean,
done.
I mean, if you say, like...
Okay, I don't remember how to develop the film, though, so you guys gotta remember how to do that.
I don't know how to do it.
Is it 30 seconds for the first
couple? Is it
40?
Guys, if we really don't know, we shouldn't be doing this. It's okay.
Just go.
I just want to get all of this done.
I hate being in here. It gives me the creeps.
Yeah, it's kind of like it's creepy in here. It's so creepy.
Is that?
Oh my goodness.
Oh, guys.
Wait.
What the heck? Is that? That's not peel, right?
No, it shouldn't.
It's a joke. Hey.
Oh my gosh, guys!
Later that day, Caitlin and I went back into the dark room to finish developing the photos. She kept asking me questions, and I didn't really know where she was going with it, but it was kind of strange.
Don't you think she kind of deserved it, though?
Wait, what?
Actually, I'm gonna go. I'm not feeling in here. Bye.
Bye, I guess.
I just really don't know who to trust at this point. I mean, both Caitlin and Brooke have given me reasons to question them. They're both acting strange, and I don't know who I can trust anymore. It's becoming kind of scary. Never in a million years did I think today was going to be the day my life flashed before my eyes.
What are you doing? Caitlin, wait!
Sugar. I won't just conform, no matter how you shake my core. 'Cause my roots, they run deep. Oh, oh yeah, so little faith. Don't doubt it, don't doubt it. Victory is in my veins. I know it, I know it. And I will not negotiate. I'll fight it, I'll fight it. I will try. sugar. Oh, honey, honey, you are my candy girl, and you got me wanting you. Honey, oh, sugar, sugar.
Don't forget, graduation. May 20th at the Cowan Civic Center in Lebanon. Exciting news! Our art department is undergoing some exciting changes. As a result of the Great Burn, LHS is hiring new art teachers. Say goodbye to Eric Adams, Elizabeth Barker, and Quentin Maxwell. And say hello to...
At Lebanon High School, all students are given the opportunity to learn, to explore, to experience, to express, and to create. Environmental limitations have no place in the arts, so wide latitude is given to students in how they express themselves. At Lebanon High School, students also learn more than a traditional art department can provide. Through programs like the Opportunities Company, and even the students' interaction with others in the department, the students learn not only about art, but about our world, other people, and about themselves.
Thank you for joining us on this episode of The Hive, and let me guess, someone stole your sweet roll. Adios!
Yeah.